very good evening, hello, and welcome to The One Show with Alex Jones.
And Matt Baker. Now, joining us tonight is a dame and a sir with around 100 awards between them.
Yes, in their honour, we have decided to roll out two red carpets tailored to their glittering careers. Please welcome Serene McKellen and Dame Judy Andrew.
Very well.
Good.
There we are.
It's wonderful to have you both.
Oh, thank you.
I'm glad we didn't wear green, aren't you?
Yes, well, people often say that.
Yes, and I did this morning.
Yes.
Now, surprisingly, you two have never worked together, but we understand, is this right, that you came very close?
Not for lack of wanting, I can tell you.
Well, you didn't know this, did you? Because I told you this morning when we bumped into each other that when you made that wonderful story about, what was she called?
Gertrude Lawrence.
Gertrude Lawrence, star.
Yes.
Because you had your old friend Noel Coward in, as one of the characters. And I went up to, I auditioned, I had a whole day pretending to be Noel Coward.
A whole day, if you please.
It was wonderful. Yes. I loved it. But I didn't get the part. They went to Dan Massey, who I think was nominated for an Oscar. So,
what could have been?
Well, we could have had such a
We could, yes. Yeah. It's not too late.
Well, still
no, no, it's fine. It's fine with me.
Well, we've had a very exciting day here.
Have you?
BBC today. Very exciting, haven't you?
What have you been up to?
Well. We've had a mass sing along.
Yeah,
to
brace
one
yourself.
A mass sing along?
Yes, to one of your famous songs.
Oh,
they're very good at waving.
Very good at waving.
Can one wave back at? No, no. Well, or are
the singing is just as good as
really?
The waving. Really? Yeah, really. But anyway, Ian, we understand that you would like to spend a little bit more time doing a bit of singing. Is that right?
Well, concentrate on it. I don't know. I mean, do you think it's too late to start singing? You
no,
don't.
No, I
you
don't. No, I don't.
I mean,
don't forget. If you don't like singing much, you can always sing speak.
Yes, exactly. You know? Yes.
We've had a little go of that.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, like Rex Harrison.
Yes, but did you never play Higgins? You'd have been wonderful.
I would have liked. I was once asked to do it with the Scottish National Opera, and
really?
I thought, no, I can't go in and speak with all these opera singers
what
around.
What you should
us,
do so. Is come and do it in concert or something.
Well.
In a big symphony orchestra.
I've picked up an agent.
Yes, I've
picked up an agent. Well, hey, listen.
Your wonderful Emma Thompson did Sweeney Todd.
Yes, that's right.
At Lincoln Center in New York. Yeah. She was fabulous. That's
there's just something about a musical, isn't there?
Yes. I can't agree with you more.
Yes.
And I had a friend who was in Salad Days. Remember Salad Days?
Yes.
It was even before The Boyfriend.
Julian...
Slade.
Slade, thank you.
And Jimmy Cairncross was in that for 8 years or something, and I said, how on earth did you do it? He said, every night I came down from the dressing room and I heard that piano and those tunes and I was away.
This is one of those remarkable actors' conversations.
Isn't it? It's just watching you two.
It's just like a dressing room, isn't it?
I'll tell you something, I don't know if it's
true. Oh, here we
go
again.
Is it true of a play, if you're fortunate enough to be in a long run, the first 3 months you're really learning your lines all over again.
Yeah.
The next 3 months of the first year, the next 3 months you're just enjoying it completely and finding nuances. The next 3 months, bringing you up to 9 months, you are listening to the orchestrations and finding things and all of that. And then the last 3 months is, well, you really have to you know, keep remembering.
Do you know, we've got loads of material planned here, but maybe
we should just chuck it out.
I think you should crack on, because this is lovely.
Well,
like
let me just finish off that, though, respond to that, because I
want to know if it's true of a blanket.
I think it is true. And,
yes.
And the way round it is to treat it each performs as if it's the
absolutely.
First one you've ever done. Because, of course, it's the
right.
first one for the audience.
Well, it is. That's right.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, we've got some rather unusual singing for you to enjoy this evening. Now, Christine Walkden has flown across London's rooftops from the Chelsea Flower Show to talk about some of the highlights, including plants that sing.
Stop.
Yeah, we're not kidding. Oh, no, honestly, no. All will be revealed
it's
later.
It's a bit hit or miss.
I cannot believe how this is done.
Well, you'll find out. She's going to be testing out the Edelweiss.
Oh,
well.
My
yes.
God.
Know, as well as
It'll
other
It'll be
plants.
An album next, won't it?
I know, yeah. Well, all this will be happening throughout the show.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So, as we mentioned, Julie, it was a very big day here at the BBC, and we wanted to do something special because we were coming, and we went slightly, well, over the top, really.
Yeah, we did. We're going to show the efforts at the end of the programme, but first, here is the story of how the whole BBC joined forces for you, Julie.
Oh, wow.
The BBC, a hotbed of creative talent. Today we're stretching our vocal cords to celebrate a movie icon in the only way we know how. A mass sing-along.
A female deer.
With our singing voices, we've got a mountain to climb. But thankfully, lots of people have turned up to help.
We just love the Sound of Music, Julie Andrews, and we've seen it so many times. It's really wonderful.
Sound of Music is a family obsession, so I had to be here.
I love to sing along to the Sound of Music because I love the film and I love Julie Andrews.
You'll have to hold on to the end of the show to hear the sound of our music.
Oh, that's a teaser, isn't it, Julie?
Yeah. You put so much work into it.
Yes.
Oh, we enjoyed every second of doing it.
Did you?
Hopefully we'll look good later.
Good.
We've not seen it yet.
Thank you. What a great compliment, too.
But we ummed and ahed for a long time on the song.
Which one it was going to be.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot to choose from. But let's talk about Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, because when you started with that, it wasn't actually in the book, was it? So how did it feel to be singing this, what must have been ridiculous?
It was OK. It wasn't in the book, but the wonderful Sherman brothers who wrote the music came up with this wonderful kind of rum-ti-tum musical song. And that was my background, was musical for years and years and years.
What your parents were on the halls?
Yes,
what
they were. So was I. All over the place.
You were a little act with them?
Yes, eventually.
Were you thrown about like Buster Keaton?
Ted Barber and Julie Andrews, yes. And a lot of people remember them, too. Yeah. They were a very good second top of the bill.
Yeah.
And my mum used to say, it's much better than being top of the bill because you don't have any of the responsibility.
But I bet you became the star, didn't you?
Well, it did eventually do that a little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, the reason you're over here, Julie, is because you're doing this fantastic evening which looks back over your life. Alla Jones is hosting with you, isn't he?
Yes.
It should be Ian. Ian should be doing it.
Well, it should be Ian.
I mean, I don't know why you're going to be in the audience. I'm going to be in the audience.
Yes. So, how would you sum up the night then?
Well, it's a speaking engagement that I've done many times. I did it in Australia last year and I had a ball. And it's really me welcoming everybody to my living room, so to speak, and it's clips, outtakes, funny stuff, montages of some of the films, lots of talk about the things that I'm passionate about and funny things that have happened along the way. And then Aled will join me in the second half, and then he really monitors all the questions and the answers that the audience submits, tons of questions.
Right.
And that's my favourite
part. I'm
sure
they do, yeah. So you said you've sort of touched on this a few times then in your life.
I've done it quite a number of times.
Does it get easier as you get older to be more, you know, open about your private life, or do you feel that you want to be more private as you get older?
I think I want to be more private as I get older.
What about you, Ian?
The older I get, the less confidence I've got that there's anything in my life that's of interest to anybody.
But my
work's one thing, but what I do when I'm not working, I don't want to talk about
that. No, I think it's...
But you've got kids, you don't want people...
No, I don't allow my kids, and right from the day they were born, I weren't allowed to be photographed or by any. There were a couple of accidents that happened, but mostly no. Because it was too dangerous,
Ian,
you've got...
I'm not. I don't have kids, no.
Do you have nephews, nieces?
Oh, yes.
There you are.
And their children.
Yes. There's nothing like a good uncle.
Yes, thank you.
Exactly. And they are going to love your new film, which is out of cinema tomorrow, isn't it?
They are, yes, they will.
It's the seventh installment of the X-Men.
It is.
And in this one, it's quite complex until you see it, but basically Wolverine is sent back, isn't he? Back in time so that he can create a better future. So he puts...
And you're sort of a bad guy, aren't you?
I do my best, but some people don't always approve of the way I do it.
I see, okay.
And when we go into the past, of course, it's not me playing Magneto, it's... The wonderful Michael Fassbender.
Yes. It is.
Oof.
Yes.
Well, let's take a look, shall we?
Oof, as she said.
You need to go to my house and find me. Convince me of all of this.
You'll need me as well.
What?
It's going to take the two of us, side by side at a time when we couldn't be further apart.
You'll have to be patient.
Patience is my strongest suit.
Basically, your body will go to sleep while your mind travels back in time. As long as you're back there, past and present will continue to coexist.
You really think this will work? I have faith in him.
Oh! Brilliant!
Only
No, we've done all that.
Okay. Yes.
Well, just watching that then, obviously in a lot of the films that you do, all these kind of sci-fi and special effects film, what is it like for you as a, you know, one of our finest theatre actors to suddenly be surrounded, well, you mentioned the green when you
yes.
came in, but
green
to be surrounded by these green screens and acting to fresh air.
An awful lot of stuff talked about green screen, which is where a screen on which later on the scenery will be projected. But
yeah.
You know,
there we are.
There we are. I'm doing something. What am I doing?
In front of a green screen?
I'm pretending to do... It's all pretending. It's called acting. Right. I'm not really up a tree. I'm not really out there. However, an awful lot of the time, particularly doing Lord of the Rings, we were there wherever we appeared
yes.
to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was when we went back into the studio to do close-ups that we mm-hmm. might work against a green screen. But, you know, if you're on stage... That isn't a castle behind.
No.
It's not a real room.
Well,
it's just scenery, so we're quite used to
it. Yeah. What is fascinating is when we look at clips like that and then we play the beautiful scenes in Mary Poppins where obviously
yes,
you were having to do with
ours was a yellow screen most of the time in those days. Yeah, it was Disney's version of a green screen.
But you were there in those
days. That was back in the early 60s, wasn't it?
That's all in front of a huge yellow screen. Had to pretend.
Oh, well, of course, for the animation, yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And but when you go across the water, then were you on, which you'll do any second now on the turtles? Were you on trolleys there? Or?
No, I just had to step on a little raised turtle, as you'll
and
see.
And don't tell me you weren't on that hill and you didn't turn round.
No, that one I did.
Oh,
that one
go.
I did.
So you were on little blocks at this point, then, as you say. You
here we go, looking down, and that little. Now I just step on. You'll see.
Oh.
Here I go, and there. And all I had to do was step on a little turtle, and the. Magic of Disney did the
yes,
rest.
Very lucky your life.
Yes, but it was a great lesson because it's the first movie I ever made and it taught me right away the patience that's needed,
mm-hmm.
especially for special effects, don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, because they take twice as long.
And that must have been one of the first films using animation and real people at the same time.
I think it was, he'd tried it in a couple of movies, but very much smaller. This was very big for Disney at the time.
Groundbreaking, really. Now, Julie and Ian, of course, have both played characters that are firm favourites when it comes to fancy dress parties. So now is your chance at home to show your versions to them.
Yes, come on, everyone at home. Send us your Magnetos, your Gandalfs, your Richard III's, your Marias and your Mary Poppins to the usual address at theoneshowbbc.co.uk.
Can I just tell you something about one of Julie's frocks in Sound of
Music? Oh, yeah, we'd love to.
One of your frocks was auctioned, and the lucky bidder was Peter Jackson, who directed Lord of the Rings.
Which?
It's at home
does
in New Zealand.
Does he wear it, or has he just quite...
Well, I said to him...
Don't answer that, it's all right.
No, I won't. I said to him at a party, has Fran, your wife, tried it on? And he said, well, yeah. He said, hey, Fran, he's asking about Julie Andrews' frock, and she said across the party, no.
No.
So I don't know where.
I'm a huge fan of his. My God.
Well, listen, Peter, if you're out there, put the dress on. Send in a picture.
Now, as we mentioned earlier, Christine is outside, and we're going to hear some singing plants. Well, we hope we are.
Oh,
yes,
I can't
we will. Let's keep everything. It's going to happen now. Christine, give us a taste. Of what have you got going on out there?
Ian, I just want you to have a look at this, because this is where science and gardening comes alive.
Okay.
This is a bronze-winning Chelsea exhibit, come all the way from that show, and it's how plants communicate. And this little device down here, this monitor, picks up the electromagnetic frequencies of these plants and makes them sing. The pineapple, a South American herbaceous plant that's really good in grating drinks. But if you caress it and you all become very quiet, you might just hear it sing. You really do? Listen.
That's real sound, this. This is real sound. Live. Ian, you look a little bit, a little bit sceptical there.
It's beautiful.
Is it not,
you do believe it?
Is it not April the 1st?
That's what I said, Ian.
I believe it, I believe it. I'm sure that's true.
Oh, welcome to the world of the one
show. We've got another two to come.
Oh, my God,
yes,
I can't
we do.
Wait.
It would make
I mean,
a
that's...
wonderful song, wouldn't it, talking to the plants and them answering back?
Yes.
That was a whole musical there.
Well, talk to the animals, that was.
Yeah.
Well, I see what you're saying, yeah. Oh, my.
Yeah, which
well,
is great.
Good
wonderful.
Luck, isn't
good
it?
Good luck,
Mike.
And the best of luck to Mike and his family. Now, if you'd like more information on how to become a stem cell donor, then visit our website, bbc.co.uk/The One Show.
And, Julie, we were just talking there, in that film, you've been doing quite a lot of research, or you have done in the past, medical research.
about 1972 or something.
All on DNA.
All on DNA and RNA and all of that. I had an idea for a book. I saw the name Wang Doodles and I thought, oh my God, long before I wrote the book, I said, I'm going to write a book called The Last of the Really Great Wang Doodles. And it was all about being the last. He needed a mate. And so they had to, I had to research like crazy. Could it be done? And yes, indeed it could.
Wow.
And with DNA and finding a, you know, getting a suitable donor and all of that.
Yeah. Do you know, we were talking about maybe doing a DNA film, so maybe if you're free, you could do that for us, Julie. That
would
be wonderful.
You've got a little bit of time in your schedule.
Now then, Julie famously sang about sugar, but our supplies of sugar would have been down to a spoonful or less if it wasn't for the fighting spirit of a particular group of factory workers during the Blitz.
Dan Snow has been to a sweet place called Silvertown to find out more.
If you head east out of the City of London, past the Isle of Dogs, you get to the narrow industrial peninsula of Silvertown. From the mid-1800s, Silvertown was the empire's gateway for raw materials and a hub for booming Britain. Its refineries and factories produced rubber, cabling, petroleum, munitions, and the sweet stuff. Sugar.
And to keep all those factories running required thousands of workers, all housed in tightly packed terraces. 3,000 of them worked at the Tate & Lyle Thames Refinery, which still dominates the skyline today. Whilst the vast Silvertown sugar refinery remains, the community that served it and made it thrive has all but disappeared.
Oh, what a story. Don't you just love Ethel? What
a great woman. She was the best, yeah.
But the tea would have been a lot less sweet, wouldn't it? You know, if it wasn't for the dedication of those factory workers, as we saw there, really.
Well, and sugar was really important for morale. The troops on the front line love a bit of sugar, so that was a key factory. And it did mean that youngsters back here at home went without. I mean, there were stories of being given carrots rather than ice creams, because and some kids didn't taste ice cream until after the war.
And kids won't believe it today. No sweets.
No.
No chocolate.
And also,
no candy bars.
Mum saying,
no
don't
sweets.
Accept sweets from strangers.
That's right.
Remember that? Yes. Because they could poison them.
We would ask the Americans for any gum chum, but I, as a kid, never had a sweet. I didn't know what it was.
That's why your teeth are so lovely.
Exactly. Look at this.
Gosh.
Well,
we did
have a good diet. Then? I mean, that's right.
Yeah. Mm. Do you remember?
And it was all organic. Everything is organic.
Now, we were reading, is this right, that you had a prisoner of war stay at your house for Christmas?
He did come, yes. Yes, there's a prisoner of war camp quite near us in Wigan. Uh-huh. We'd had evacuees during the war from Middlesex, the Levicks, Mrs. Levick and her two children. And if they're watching, get in touch, because we've not seen each other for 60 years, 70 years. But, so they lived with us for a year. And then my parents were good people, and they thought the war's over, and some poor German who, away from his family, needs a bit of comfort at Christmas. Yeah. So he came round and spent Christmas Day with us, yeah.
Wow. Well, and if the Levicks are watching, do email them.
That'd be nice.
You never know, we might find them before the end of the show.
Yeah.
And Julie, you were a bit older, weren't you, during the war, but you were living in Camden, so had lots of experience of sheltering from the Blitz raids down in the tube stations.
In the tube with my mum and dad, my mum and stepfather, yes, and the guitar, which was very important to the vaudeville act. And then, we would run down there.
And did you do concerts down there?
My dad did. He entertained down there.
It's the iconic image
Look
of the place,
that.
Isn't
Look
it?
At that. Yeah. And Sir Henry Moore, of course, made that so famous with his wonderful...
What else do you remember of that?
Very
time.
Smelly. Oh, God, it was... They had little burners down there, which they cooked on them, and then there were babies and nappies being changed and... toilets and God knows what, yeah.
Wow. 150,000 people a night would head down to the...
Yes, and it was safe. I mean, it's the only way you could be sure.
Yeah, it's the perfect location, really. Yeah.
Now, we're going to talk now about the Doodle Bug dancer. Just give us a little bit of information about that.
Well, that, as these guys know, these were unpiloted bombs. They were jet engines with explosives on them, the sort of precursor to our cruise missiles now, if you like. The Germans launched them from northwest Europe against... Yeah. London in particular, mm-hmm. and here, there's a picture of one here, and they were terrifying because they weren't manned, and it was a hint of that kind of the future of warfare that we got
yes,
now, really.
It's scary to hear one coming over, it really
and
was.
Is it right that you used to be able to
well,
pick
yeah,
up that and have
my
a whistle?
Parents, you know, towards the end of the war, which is when the doodlebugs were coming fast and furious, mm-hmm. it was towards the end, but no housewife could bake a cake or do their washing or get the laundry done or anything, change the beds. So that my mum would stay in the house till the last possible moment, and Muggins would have to go out and sit on top of the shelter with a whistle and an umbrella because it was always raining. And I protested mightily, but no, I could tell the difference then, I don't know if I still could, between a doodlebug and one of ours. And when I heard a doodlebug coming, I'd blow the whistle and everybody would Stop run up. Into the shelter. Yes.
And the, and the umbrella, did you then float up into
no,
the air?
No, no.
Nice, nice.
And well, of course, one day I forgot to blow the whistle. I wouldn't go. I was pouring with rain. And so many neighbours came around and said, bloody hell, why didn't she blow her whistle? We were all caught unawares, you know. And they'd been relying on it.
Well, Dan's found these brilliant audio files, so we can actually hear the sound of the doodlebug now.
Let me hear.
Here we are.
It had a drone.
Still familiar.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a horrible noise, actually.
Does any, I don't know if anybody else remembers.
Well, let's lift our spirits, shall we? Shall we have another singing plant?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh,
I love that. That's what we'll do.
Yes, let's get them going.
What are we going to have
Christine, yeah, well, let's find out. Christine, what have you got for us this time?
I've got a fern, but she's been a bit of a diva and she's got stressed out at being at Chelsea. But, Julie, you have got such experience. Would you like to pass on a few top tips to make her relax?
To make her relax?
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, she can't have a nice, gentle cup of tea or anything, can she? No.
No.
I think maybe just a little misting would be a good idea for a plant.
She doesn't do it, but never mind, because we have got Edelweiss, and you certainly know an awful lot about this.
Yeah, Edelweiss is Julie.
Small and white, clean and bright, Edelweiss.
Wow. Well, I never knew that plants could make noises.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
Thank you very much, Christine. And speaking of Edelweiss,
thank you, Christine.
Coming up, we've got a mass sing-along of Doremi in homage to Julie here.
Yes. There we are. Hey, let's have a look. There we are, look. Over 100 people joined in, including Jimmy Collins.
There's a green screen, see?
And the BBC weather team. Very good.
Now, we were inspired by this particular number from The Sound of Music.
Oh, how vivid is that memory of you sat right there in that very spot
very
singing to those children?
And that's not green screen, that is really Austrian Alps. Yeah.
So was there lots of rehearsing then?
Yes, lots. We did a lot of pre-rehearsals, though, mm-hmm. in the studio. We mapped out the number of stairs we would be walking down and where we would be running here and what we would be doing there. So the choreography was rare. We knew it before we even got there, and then it was a case of
And looking at that particular scene there, I mean, your finger placement on guitar was
well,
superb.
Thank you. I had a horrible time doing it. They kept saying, we want you back in the trailer now to keep practicing, you know? Because I didn't really...
You didn't play guitar?
Not until I had... I couldn't do it now.
And did you play a little bit after? I play guitar myself.
Do you?
Yes, I'm sorry.
My grandson does. One of my grandsons. Well, two of my grandsons, actually.
Are you saying you didn't play the guitar?
No, I did.
Oh, no, she did.
I did, but it took, you know, I mean, I couldn't do it now.
No.
No, it's quite intricate.
Do you?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Well, Julie's big break on the silver screen is down to one of the biggest film producers in the world.
Yes, and years before he set eyes on Julie, he spent a bit of time over here. Here's Giles.
This little Lincolnshire village has a surprising and star-studded connection with Hollywood. The clue is in the name, Norton Disney. It was here on the 6th of July, 1949, that Walt Disney, creator of countless children's classics, arrived unexpectedly with his wife and two children. The local newspapers reported that he was on his holidays. He was keen to visit St. Peter's Parish Church to look at the graves. Alan Haynes is Norton Disney's local historian.
Walt Disney came here, stood here, and do you think he thought, well, is there a family resemblance?
Walt could trace his own family back to the 1700s in Kilkenny, Ireland. but had never found records dating back any further. The Norton Disneys buried here at St. Peter's came from a powerful French family and arrived in England sometime after the 11th century. And the belief is the Disney family came over after the Norman Conquest and settled here.
Well, they came over shortly after William the Conqueror came in 1066, and it's thought they came over towards the end of that century.
And they settled here for hundreds of years. So were they related to Walt? He seemed to think so, and although the footage has never been released, he spent some time filming the tombs on his cine camera. The storylines of many Disney movies feature a strange soul searching for their family. So perhaps it was a case of life imitating art when Walt Disney visited Norton Disney to rifle through the parish records. The current custodian of those records is Dr. Mike Rogers from the Lincolnshire Archives.
What's the earliest reference to the family you found in your archives?
This little deed here, which dates from the late 13th century, does mention paying a rent to Lord William de Isny.
De Isny means of Isny, from the French. And at that time, spelling hadn't settled down, so you'd expect a variety of spellings of the name.
Absolutely. I mean, the people probably couldn't write themselves. It's just how the person writing the deed heard the name.
By what time have we got the name Disney as we'd recognise it?
Certainly, 16th century, we're getting recognisable Disneys with an EY at the end. Yeah.
But the spelling of his family name isn't the only parallel between Walt and these Lincolnshire nobles.
It does mention, as one of the boundaries of the land, a bit of a ceiling of land called Disneyland.
Ah! Disneyland, there it is! The original Disneyland. What does this date from?
1386.
1386, folks, 1386. It all started in Lincoln. I knew it, you know. I absolutely knew it. We've got rights in that mouse.
So is there a link between Walt Disney and the Disneyland of Lincolnshire? Remarkably, one record states, in 1651, a branch of the Disney family certified by William Disney of Norton Disney was established in Ireland. But sadly, there's still no evidence to prove that the noble Norton Disneys were related to Walt's own Irish bloodline. Proof or not, Walt's living relatives seem to have made up their minds about the origins of their family name. Because 50 years later, when his niece also came to visit the Disney tombs, she signed the visitor's book, Mary S. Disney, direct descendant.
No. What a brilliant, brilliant story.
These two are at it again. They're just chatting away.
They're having a little chat.
We're back on.
Yeah, we're back on.
We can't stop chatting. No, yet.
Can we ask you about Mary Poppins? Because is it right that you originally turned down the role?
No, I didn't turn it down. Mr. Disney came backstage when I was performing in Camelot and asked, I mean, I thought he was just being nice and coming to visit, but he asked, would I be interested in coming to Hollywood to see the designs and to hear the songs that he was planning for this movie that he intended to make. And I was horrified, and I said, oh, Mr. Disney, I would love it, I would love it, but I have to tell you, I'm pregnant. I was 3 months pregnant. And he said, well, that's all right, we'll wait.
Oh,
and, you know, because they were barely in pre-production, so you know how long it takes to get a movie up and running and ready for the screen, by which time I'd had my lovely daughter, Emma, and 3 months after she was born, off I went with my husband at that time to Disney.
And Camelot, and you did that with Richard Burton?
Yes.
And anybody else?
Billy Squires subbed for Richard at one point, and when he, after Richard left, he left before I did. He went off to make Cleopatra, Richard.
Do you always get a little tingle when you come back to London? Because honestly, when I drive home, I always think about Mary Poppins and, you know.
Especially if it's in the spring and things like, I mean, I love this country. I love my country. It is my country. Yeah.
And isn't it the best thing that our greatest performer of your generation sings with an English accent?
Oh, yes. Love it.
Well, I've had to lend you a little bit, but no, I mean, nobody has ever been to one of your concerts or seen you or heard you sing without hearing every single word.
Well, that's brilliant. Right. That was my lovely singing teacher. She was a stickler for diction. Yeah. And hang on to your words and your voice will follow.
Do you know, we had something planned a little bit earlier, and I don't know if we've still got it there, but we have a clip of you at the age of 12 years old in your first performance.
Really?
Let's have a listen.
know how extraordinary you were?
No, of course I didn't.
It was just what you did.
Yeah, it's what I did, and I had Brilliant. This kind of adult larynx in a very young
Yeah, your
kid.
Voice matured yeah, very
and that
early,
was my,
didn't it?
My stock in trade all the time I was in vaudeville. Mm. I was belting out those kind of bastardised versions of operatic arias, you know. Mm. Yeah.
And, Ian, what was the moment for you when you first went to theatre and thought, this is it for me, this is what I want my life to be?
You will know who I'm talking about. I saw Ivor Novello in King's Rhapsody.
Oh, my God! No. It wasn't with Anna...
I love this.
No, not Anna Neagle. It was Vanessa Lee.
Yes,
and,
that's right.
Olive Gilbert and the Xenophilus Dare.
Oh, my God!
Bobby Andrews, no relation.
No, but Xena was in My Fair Lady.
Oh, yes, of course she was.
She was in the My Fair Lady production in London.
But, you see, Ivor Novello was before Oscar and Hammerstein, before...
Oh, Lloyd Webber.
He was our great Welsh, the great Welsh composer.
We'll gather
and with that crossover, is it fair to say that you came to film fairly late?
No, because I've made films ever since I started. They were all so bad you never saw them, thank goodness. the very, very first film I made was called The Bells of Hell Go Ting-a-ling-a-ling, and it was a First World War movie, adventure movie, set during the summer in Switzerland, and it was taking advantage of the success of Sound of Music. There were lots of kids in it.
Wow.
There was no music, but, oh, I think they actually did sing a bit. And the snow started early that year.
Well, it can,
and started snowing, and the whole film was abandoned. So and it was the best thing that ever happened to me. I got £4,000, my entire salary, and I could put it in the bank and go and work wherever I wanted.
Mm. But the big success, there was Richard III. That was the film that actually catapulted you into the big time, so
well,
to speak,
I think
in
that's
the world
when
of films.
Film people thought, oh, well, perhaps he doesn't just shout all the time.
Yes. Oh, you did. And honestly, you had a real effect on me with that. Let's just have a look at one of those key speeches.
Now is the winter of our discontent made glorious summer by this son of York. And all the clouds that lowered upon our house in the deep bosom of the ocean buried.
And Maggie.
Maggie Smith there playing my mother, yes. She wasn't best pleased about that.
But the technique there, because you make it very accessible.
Well, I went to the Julie Andrews School of Diction, you can tell.
But you can't pretend that you couldn't sing, not with that voice.
Ah, well, thank you. Yes. Well, all right. I'm going to take that as, an encouragement.
Let's do one together.
But obviously, I mean, the difference, what you must have felt there, filming that scene to doing that speech, you know, in front of a full auditorium.
The best thing about that was that I'd played it so long on stage that when it came into the studio, all I had to concentrate on was not how to play it, but not what I was going to do with it, but what I was going to do with it in terms of it being cinema rather than theatre.
Yeah.
So it was a good way of doing a major part in a film for the first time.
Wonderful. They're wonderful. Mm.
You know, I think it is exactly that. We were just saying there.
Yes.
The painted... I've got a lot of guidebooks. I do a programme on agriculture, country farm and what have you, and I often find...
I'll just get the plug in.
No, it's true. you use all those painted ones and you get a lot more information out of it just by looking.
Well, we've left Christine. We've let her come in because it was cold out there in the winter, wasn't it, Christine?
It was a little bit nippy.
It was. So you've brought in these lovely plants.
I can smell this.
This one's gorgeous, isn't it?
Oh, I have. What is it? It's a rose, obviously, but this is a very beautiful new rose just introduced. This is Rosa David Austin, Anna Austin, and just Julie, have a whiff.
I can smell it from here. But hold on. Mm.
It's gorgeous.
She's beautiful.
Oh, my God.
Well, compact growth, disease-free. It is a really good rose.
Well,
and there's
the
some
Austin
other
are,
lovely
yeah.
new introductions.
That's what I was going to say. They're all debuting, aren't they at Chelsea this year.
And the plant of the year, Hydrangea Miss Sayori. Good, very full heads that are going to stand up and look glorious.
Oh, how beautiful they're going to look.
Beautiful colour graduation. That's the plant of the year.
When they arrive and cut off and they're not growing anymore,
They will last beautifully.
What, do I put
off.
An aspirin in the water? Sugar, a bit of sugar, spoon.
Oh, you're talking about
sugar.
Flour arrangement.
Right. Yes.
If you wish to arrange it, yes, cut it to a slanting cut.
Yes.
Aspirin, a little bit of sugar, and just leave it to develop to the full
flush. Are you a cane gardener?
I'm more of a flower arranger.
Okay.
Well, for the other.
I do. I love having flowers in the house, and I love tidging them. I tidge them.
And do you
love
that word.
Yeah.
In the sort of the dressing room and what have you, do you have flowers in the dressing room? And do you always?
Oh,
ask
if people bring, I love being given flowers. Yes.
What any
it's
particular
my birthday
varieties?
On Sunday.
I know what to get you. Okay.
Yes.
But
not so good on gardening, though.
But if you're a florist and you love that creation, that is the plant for you.
This
one, Hydrum Neptune's Gold.
Oh, yeah.
The foliage will intensify to a really good gold.
Yeah. Wow.
And then you get a purple striation right up the stem, metallic purple.
Indoors.
Outdoors. And then the head of the flower will turn the most intense metallic blue, and there's a yellow roof to her.
Good
she
Lord.
Looks so beautiful in an arrangement. She's elegant.
What's her name?
She is Erysimum Neptune's Gold.
Neptune's
brand
gold.
New. That's a
brand
heck
new.
Of a good plant.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, you've got some gorgeous ones here.
And talking of keeping them indoors, outdoors, and the weather and what have you, obviously it's been a real challenge, hasn't it, for Chelsea gardeners there, because a lot of the flowers are wilting.
Well, we've had it hot and we've had it cold, but that's the skill of the British horticulturalist, and you see it nowhere else in the world executed to such a level than at the Chelsea Flower Show. So many expert growers coming together at one space. That is what makes Chelsea the flower show of horticulture.
And is it to do with the fact that we've got allotments here, do you think?
Allotments, growing skill, a history of growing.
Do other countries have allotments?
Some of the European countries do, yes.
Indeed. What fascinates me is that a lot of them are very small plots, and what you can get in and the stories that you can tell in such a short space. Mm-hmm. You don't need a big garden at all, do you?
You should go, Julie, while you're over.
I'm going to try. I am going to try.
Mm. Still a few days.
But you should engage with plants, because people think you need acres. No, you don't.
No.
You need a windowsill, a window box. You just need to enjoy that plant. And you don't need acres. One plant can set you on fire.
Pity she's not enthusiastic, isn't it?
It's a good point, though, I mean, because we are surrounded by everything that's in pots at the moment.
Absolutely.
So,
and what glorious display. Gallardia celebration, a brand new plant, much more compact than we've ever seen in the Gallardias. Mm. Bleed free, by which we mean the flowers remain intensely red and don't fade out. A good container plant, great in the garden, and that's going to be a very, very popular garden
does
plant.
Does it keep repeating?
It does. Yeah. A very long flowering season, quite hardy. It's a perennial, so it'll come back year after year after year and give you a lot of pleasure.
And I'm noticing things like azaleas now. They're prolonging their life, so they re-bloom, which they never used to do. Now they're affected genetically.
You see that big telly there? We'll switch that to BBC Two as soon as we finish, because at 8 o'clock the Chelsea Flower Show will be on.
Oh, okay.
Can have a watch.
Find out all about it.
Yeah.
Now then, here we go, because more excitement to follow, because the time has come for us to show off our mass sing-along.
Oh, I can't.
Do-re-mi. In order, of course, of you, Julie.
We're a bit nervous about this, Julie, so bear with us. We have to say thanks to all the people and the choirs who gave us a hand today, and a special thank you to the people at Sing Along A Sound of Music for spreading the word for us.
Yes. Ian, do you want some words so that you can sing
We've
along?
Got some song sheets.
Yeah.
I know them all.
Here we go, then. Sit back, relax, and enjoy it.
Let's see.
Doe, a deer, a female deer.
Bray, a drop of golden sun.
Me, a name I call myself.
A long, long way to run.
So, a needle poking thread.
A note to follow so.
Tea, a drink with jam.
Yeah.
female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun.
Me, a May, I call myself.
More of a kind of Julie Andrews mash-up, that. There was a few Mary Poppins in there.
I saw some Mary Poppins in there. Yes. Well, it's all right.
Yeah. Yeah, creative license.
Brilliant, brilliant. Good. I want a copy of that.
All right, then.
Can I get a copy?
Yeah, of course you can.
Oh, absolutely.
I'd love that.
Yeah,
Your Honour, wouldn't it?
We'll give one to you too, Ian, for your
birthday. Yes, thank you.
Now, if you could just get them to sing Happy Birthday to Ian.
I'm sure we can arrange that.
Yeah.
Now, thank you so much as well for sending in your photos of you dressed up as one of Ian or Julie's iconic characters. We've had loads.
Now, look, this is Richard and Friends from Leiston. And this costume, it's made entirely of curtains. All of them, apparently. Oh. So, well done. Thanks for sending that in.
Oh, look at that.
Now, then, this is Laura from Glasgow dressed as Gandalf for a musical theatre-themed pub crawl.
Oh. Excellent.
Themed pub crawl?
Oh, yes.
Now, World Book Day is a big deal for 5-year-olds all across it. Here we go. Look, this is Evie Gamage.
That's an important day.
Aww,
she's
that's
fine.
Cute.
Yes.
Another little one. This is Charlotte at her Mary Poppins themed second birthday party.
Oh, that's so sweet.
And we should finish with Josh and his brother dressed up as Goku and Magneto. There we are.
Oh, great.
And we were just saying there that you could actually be an X-Men because you have a metal foot.
Yes, I do. I'm a bionic woman. Did you know that?
I did not know
that. I have a bionic ankle.
How come?
About 2 years ago. Well, it was so bad, I had to do that or end up in a wheelchair. So I had it done, and it is brilliant. And it doesn't go off because it's titanium. It doesn't go off through the airports or anything.
Does it manipulate itself, or do you have to...?
No, it's in there, and I make it. The muscles are all still around it.
Well,
but it's the most beautiful piece of equipment, it really
brilliant.
Is. It's like having a hip or knees. Yes. You know?
The eighth X-Men. You could join in, Julie.
Can I just say that I've thoroughly enjoyed listening to the pair of you. Yes. Wonderful night. It really was nice, isn't it?
You've been wonderful.
We're doing
very much to you both. Thanks, Ian. And all the best for the new X-Men movies out in cinemas tomorrow, Days of Future Past.
Yeah, if you do want to sit there and keep talking, you know, feel free. Anyway, good luck with the tour, which starts tomorrow in Birmingham this Saturday.
And we'll see you tomorrow with Neil Morrissey.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.